Welcome to the Influential Motherhood Podcast. I'm your host, Melissa Duncan, and my dream is to inspire moms to pursue their goals and help them make a difference in their world. I'm a mom of two young boys, a wife to my high school sweetheart, and a lawyer. This show is a place to hear stories of moms working hard to have a positive influence in their profession or their community, and sometimes both, even as they juggle their responsibilities at work, at home, and to their children. You'll get tangible, practical tips for managing the chaotic world of motherhood and work. Come along as we hear these stories and feel inspired to step outside of our comfort zone as leaders and as a positive force within our communities. I believe that moms can change the world. Okay, so I'm here today with Maghon Taylor from All She Wrote Notes. And Maghon is a mom, first and foremost, of the cutest little boy and an entrepreneur. And she works from home. She's a calligrapher and a hand lettering artist and instructor. So welcome, Maghon. Thank you for being on the podcast.
Thank you so much for having me. This is exciting.
This is fun. This is really fun. We're actually in the same area code. So this is fun to like be chatting from the same area code. So why don't you just start out by telling us a little bit about your background and kind of how you got here today and where you are in your career?
Sure, of course. I have always been a doodler and a drawer, kind of like an artist at heart. Even growing up, I always had my hands in some kind of paint or markers or something to be creative. And even I have memories all the way back to middle school and high school, making stuff for friends or teachers and passing it around. But I didn't start my business until after college. I had worked in event planning for 7 years after I graduated, and I loved being in events. I loved decorating. I loved coming up with ideas. I loved spending other people's money, like that was really good. But I just missed being creative. I had the kind of job where they paid for my phone, which was awesome when you're like 21, and then you realize that that means you're always on duty. And so I just, I worked a lot of long hours and late hours, and I just missed being creative. I missed doing something for fun, and I got to the point that I could not remember the last time that I just crafted or doodled or drew something or wrote a note for somebody. And so that year for my birthday, I took a calligraphy course, and when I'm talking about calligraphy, I'm talking about the old-fashioned, like, metal-tipped pointed pen that you dip into a little jar of ink, like, old school. And I took that class and just had really high hopes of, like, being good and loving it and basically everything that's happened now, except for I was horrible. Like, I was so bad. I was the worst one in the class. And I just, I left feeling really discouraged and like I wasn't good enough and really comparing myself to the other people in the course. And I wasn't ready to give up. I had spent a lot of money in all that equipment, like all the pens and ink, and I was really in deep. And so I was like, okay, I need to keep practicing, even if it's just on my own for fun. And that's what I did. I just started doodling and drawing and giving notes as gifts and doing all these things that like I used to do all the time as a kid, but bringing that into my adult life. And it was because of the encouragement of my girlfriends and my coworkers who saw my work and were just so praiseworthy and like, you should share these, like you should sell these online. And I started from my bed on my iPhone 4.
Like, that's awesome.
I did not have internet. I did not have a printer, a scanner, a computer. Everything was done by hand. So, like, way manual. But I loved it. All She Wrote Notes has been in business over 5 years now. I've been full-time for more than 3 years. And it's just been the biggest blessing in my life. Like, it was not my plan. Like, but it's been amazing. It's been incredible. It's just been a cool journey. And now I teach lessons and I travel all across North Carolina and the South. I was actually in Dallas this week teaching hand lettering and teaching calligraphy. And my heart behind everything is spreading happiness through my handwriting. So anything that I draw or write or create, I want it to put a smile on somebody's face.
That's amazing. And so why don't you, we'll obviously have pictures associated with all the publicity around this post, but maybe differentiate for people through words, I guess, your hand lettering now versus that old style calligraphy course that you took?
Sure. The class was super formal. It's a style that's called copper plate calligraphy, which is very, very traditional. So think like back if you're planning a black tie wedding or like a correspondence from the White House, like it's going to look extremely elegant, extremely formal. The letters are more small and really close together. And I kind of took on my own style and started to really make it my own at the encouragement of my friends. And my writing is a lot more whimsical. It's a lot more casual. It's more bouncy. It's more playful. Like the letters have like thicker lines. They have like swirls and curls and just a lot of fun flourishes. And it's got personality, to say the least. So you can tell I wrote it. Like it's funny because people will see my writing and they know that it's mine because it's just really cheerful. And again, like even those letters, like I want this to be happy and be fun, because I'm constantly telling my students that it does not have to be perfect to be good, and it doesn't have to be like you're not trying to win a handwriting award. Right. You just need to do this for yourself and like find that space in your life that you can just create and do something for you and do something for fun, but also like with that mission to bless others. Like it just kind of comes right back to you.
That's awesome. So now you were in your other career of in event planning, and then you were also doing your hand lettering business. And that was all before you had a kid. And yes. So it sounds like there was a period of time where you were doing both of those. And so what was that like as you kind of moved towards, full-time business owner, but you weren't quite there yet?
Yes.
And you had a career and a side hustle.
It was crazy, but it was awesome. Like, I would not change a thing. Like, I loved it. I would work all the way until, like, 5 or 6 o'clock, come home, pack orders, write items for people, let them dry. Like, overnight, you have to lay out calligraphy to let it dry. Mm-hmm. And I would wake up the next morning, pack it, take it to the post office, and go to work, and then do it all over again. And it was just such a perfect season in my life to start something, because I wasn't married. I wasn't even engaged to Chris yet. He actually lived in Greensboro, and I lived close to Chapel Hill. And so that's where I was working. And I mean, I came home every night and did that, but I had nothing else to do. So there was really not anything I would rather have been doing than building my business and working. And I could tell from really early on that it was really starting to just like kind of gain momentum, and it was really moving forward. And the job that I was in, I loved. I was working for my alma mater, and that was my dream job. It was amazing. I enjoyed my coworkers. Like, there's not anything at all negative I could ever say about it, but I could just tell that my business was really growing, and right. Financially, it made sense for me to actually leave, and I would have an opportunity to make more money in my own business than I was making at work. And so, on paper, the decision was really clear, but it took me a long time to catch up with that, because yeah. I loved my friends. Like, I really didn't want to leave my coworkers.
Yeah.
And so that's, I stayed longer than I really needed to, but I don't regret that at all. It was a good time. And then I went full time in 2015. So right after Chris and I got married, and that was awesome. Like, it was so funny though, because I kept thinking like, oh, as soon as I go full time, like I'll have all this extra time. Like I thought there were these like buckets of time that I was like missing, and that was not true. That was not the case. Yeah. It's just like your money. Like, it's just like your budget. Like, you will spend it all. Like, if you have all this time, you will use it all, and you will find something to do with it. And I mean, I was never once bored for a second. I even felt overwhelmed, like, because then when you're full time, it's just more pressure. Like, you have to say yes. Like, you need to say yes. Like, you need to take these orders. Like, you need to ship these things, like, so that you have time for more. And it was a really cool season. That first year full time, that was before I was pregnant, and it was just full speed ahead. But I'm really glad that it worked out the way it did, because I got pregnant with Vance in May of 2016, and I was very, very sick during pregnancy. I was sick every single day. I was really down, and it did not let up for the whole entire time. And it really, like, took a lot out of me. Like, I think I was really struggling with some prepartum depression, which we didn't really know at the time. And it just threw me off my game. Like, yeah. I was not myself. And I really had to slow down for the first time in the whole business. And I think that the Lord was just preparing me for, like, what motherhood was going to be like. Like, yeah. Not being sick, but just, like, you're going to be slowed down. Like, you can't keep up at this pace. Like, it's just impossible. And so when Vance was born, like, I honestly felt like a million bucks. I was like, let's get, you know, like, let's, now I'm back. Like, let's get back in this. And so I've been able to go back to work and, you know, been so grateful that I have that opportunity, but I have a ton of help. Like, my sister helps me and, you know, it's just, it's really great. It's just a different pace than what I was used to, but it's still really good.
That's awesome. So you were still kind of, though, growing your full-time business, you know, once you became a mom. Because, I mean, just as I've watched your business, it seems like it's just growing and growing. And so you've really experienced growth in your business as a new, you know, young mom. And what has that been like? How has motherhood impacted, you know, being a full-time entrepreneur for you?
That's such a good question. I think motherhood has made me, it's just made me more clear on like my goals and more clear on what matters and what I should be spending my time doing, both in my business and outside of my business. I'm a pleaser by heart. Like, I love to say yes to people, and I would do all these things almost out of obligation because I didn't want to say no to somebody. I didn't want to let anybody down, but it wasn't really the best use of my time. And now that I have to pay for childcare hourly, I'm a lot more selective about what I actually do. I have to make good financial decisions with my time to make sure that it's going to not impact the bottom line in a negative way. And then I think too, just about being more focused. Like, I have never been more like focused in all my life. Like, when I'm at work, I'm like a machine. I am like on, like, so that when I get off and when I'm done with work for the day, I just get to be mom. Like, I just get to play with Vance and enjoy him and soak him in. Like, I don't feel pulled and, you know, like in a different direction. And so it's really just made me focus. And my business is still growing. I think I worried for a while that I would come back from maternity leave and I would be irrelevant, because a lot of my my clients have always kind of been in my same life stage, like kind of just my same age range. Like when I was engaged, I was doing a lot of bridal stuff. And when I was pregnant, I started doing pregnancy stuff. And, you know, now that I have a kid, I have kids clothes. Like, but I worried a lot that I somehow, this doesn't make any sense, but I was afraid that they weren't going to be interested and that they weren't going to follow me through this stage. And it's actually been just the opposite. Like, I've been able to, I mean, motherhood is the best hood, right? Like,
right. I love absolutely.
It. And it's just been so cool to be supported by other moms and by other people. I can just relate to people on another level that I wasn't able to before. And I think too, like, nothing happens overnight. And so I am getting, you know, big things are happening for me and my business, and I'm being blessed with a lot of opportunities, but I didn't start yesterday. I'm 5 years in and this stuff is just now happening. And so in some ways it feels like, oh my gosh, like, this is, you know, cool. But then in other ways it's like, finally,
I've been working so hard
for this. But it's awesome. I feel like we're hitting our stride. And you know, especially like this year, like balancing it with motherhood, it's kind of like I've gotten used to my new normal, and I just feel a lot more confident. I'm like in everything than I did last year.
Yeah, that's great. So do you, I know you're, or at least from what I gather, you know, on your Insta stories, that your main office is in your home. And so you have a home office. But you just said, you know, that you do feel like you are able to have a clean break. And when it's time to spend time with your, you know, your husband and your son, you're able to. I know a lot of people who work from home who say, you know, it's really hard to feel like I can actually stop working. So how do you do that? What are the measures that you have in place for you and your family to be able to truly say, okay, the end of my workday is done.
Right.
Now we're going to be together.
I love this. A lot of it is just childcare related. It's that, like, I can't work and have him up here because he's like a little mini tornado. And so
he draws on the wall, like, right?
Yeah, he does. Yeah. I've taught him how to use a Sharpie, which that, my bad. Like, whoops, like, should not have done that. And so he, like, takes out markers and he'll take out art supplies and just starts drawing on my walls, which, I mean, deep down I kind of love. But then, like, the other day, he, like, took his talents to the furniture, and I was like, oh no. This is my fault. Like, this is my... And he, like, he'll pull coffee mugs off the shelves. Like, we have a lot of confetti here. I turn all my calligraphy mistakes into confetti, and he knows where the confetti is, and he'll go and get it out and throw it around. down. And we bought like a new vacuum cleaner, like just for the office, because he was throwing so much confetti around. And so I've taught him how to use the vacuum cleaner.
Oh, perfect. And he can, there you
clean
go.
Clean it up. But like, it's just too hard to have him up here. It's like the opposite of everything I would want. Like, I don't want to be, if he's wanting to play with art supplies, I want to be playing with him. Like, I want to be engrossed in that, like cheering him on. I don't want to be like, oh my gosh, like you, like, I don't want him to get in trouble for doing that. And I don't, like, I want to celebrate that he's, like, helping me put stickers on packages, not, like, being angry that he messed it up and did it wrong. And so, it's just better for me to separate them. Our office is actually above our garage, so it is kind of separate from our house. Like, it's got a different staircase, and you enter it, like, it's like a bonus room, like, picture that, like, above our garage. Yeah. And so, you enter it, like, in a separate part of the house. So, once I come downstairs, I don't walk by it again. Like, there's no need to come back up here. And so, that's turn out all the lights. Like, I mean, I shut it down. And my husband works third shift. And so, he's gone every single night, and he sleeps during the day. And so, our time together is usually from, like, 3 to 5 in the afternoon. And so, some days, he's able to pitch in and help me get more work done, because like our babysitter leaves at 2, and so he's able to like kind of pinch it for me like if it's a really busy day or if I needed a call or a meeting, like he'll help me in that hour. But then I always love to get done and go down and spend the time with him, because that's really the only time that the three of us are together during the week. And so it's just like, I think it's helpful to me that he does have that strict schedule, because that time is so important to me, and it's so limited. So it's like, I have to go down or else I'm not going to see him.
Yeah.
And so it's always an option for me to come back up here at night if I need to, like after Vance goes to bed. But honestly, like it's very rare that I actually do. And it's just, you know, I'm just ready to hit it in the morning, like, and get going. But I think if, you know, my advice to anybody that works from home is that if you can shut that door, like even if you have to lock the door, like to your office or to your studio, like leave work, you know, and leave work at work. Like, I wouldn't recommend making your office your bed, or making your office your kitchen table, or like a space in your home that is shared with other people or that you're going to have to walk by, because you're never going to clean off your to-do list. And that was something that was really hard for me to learn my first, you know, few months as an entrepreneur, because it seemed like at work, like at my day job, at my 9-to-5, I could check it all off. Like, I could complete it. I could get through. And now I don't, and you know, I don't want to, because if I'm done, that means there's no orders waiting. That means there's nothing like outstanding, like nothing, no money coming in.
Yeah.
So I don't want to be finished. Like, I want to keep it moving, but there will always be something to be done. It's just that when I have that time with Chris and Vance, I really try to give them that attention and give them that time.
That's great. What do you think is the hardest part of being a working mom for you?
For me, it's the guilt when I travel. Yeah. And I had a really good,
a lot.
Yeah. I travel at least once a month, and it's not that I'm going really far, and it's not that I'm staying gone really long. It's just that since there's not another parent here at night, Vance has to go and stay somewhere else, because Chris is at work at night, and you know, I have to arrange other childcare with him. So our parents freaking love that. Like my mom and dad are so excited. They're like, keep going. And Chris's parents are super helpful too. They live about 45 minutes away from us in Summerfield.
Oh, yeah.
And so they're wonderful. They're so great. And I don't know, like, I'm really, really working on that and praying about that. And I asked Chris the other day, I was like, does it bother you? Because we're booking travel for next year, and I'm already like, I already look at the calendar and know that I'm gone like probably at least once a month overnight. And he was like, no, it doesn't bother me. He's like, this is fine. Like, this, you're working. Like, this is for work. And it felt so good to hear that from him, because it's not like I'm just like taking vacations. You know what I mean? Like, peace out. And I find that I'm always super excited to leave. Like, because I do work from home and I am the only parent, like, it's a really good break for me. Like, it's a really good recharging to talk to other adults and to be around other business women. Like, it's always really refreshing to me to go to these conferences or speak at these events or go teach classes somewhere else. But I cannot wait to get back. Like, I mean, any time that I've been gone, even for a couple of nights, I'm like, oh, I can't wait to get home. Like, I get almost more excited to come home than I did to leave. But I don't think I should feel guilty. I think that it's one of those things, like, nobody's asking Chris, like, how he balances it, you know? Like, I mean, he works third shift. He's here less than anyone in the house, and nobody asks him. And so it's just hard to, like, kind of work through that. And that's something I've never thought about or never even worried or experienced until I became a mom. And I think it's not even anyone else putting that on me. It's kind of me dealing with it myself. But I think up until I became a mom, especially with Chris's schedule, there was nothing else I would rather be doing than working. You know, like, there was nothing else I'd rather be doing than traveling and teaching. And now you've given me this other option that's really great. And I love being a mom. I love being around my son. And I just think that sometimes that's hard when I know that I'm giving up time with him to be other places. But I really do feel like God called me to go out there and encourage other women. I feel like he's given me the alphabet. Like, I have these letters and I have these tools and techniques I can teach and share. But more than that, it's just encouraging people to be more positive and to celebrate life and to try to find the good. And, you know, life is hard and there's just so many things that can be negative. And I just, even motherhood, like, you hear people, you'll never hear me complain about motherhood or, like, about Vance's behavior. Like, I'll laugh it off or I'll joke, but, like, I love it. Like, I truly think it's so great. And I think so many people give it a bad rap.
Yes.
And I don't think it's like that. I think that you can choose to make it what you will. And I just want to have fun. And I think that there's just more good than bad, like, in the whole entire, you know, motherhood situation. And so I love being able to spread that message too.
Well, you absolutely do. I'm just sitting here listening to you smiling.
Oh, thank you.
And I think that that's so refreshing, you know, because I think it's almost a thing, and I'm using air quotes, to, like, give motherhood a bad rap. Do you know what I mean? Like,
I agree. It's totally
almost like
agree.
The cool thing to do.
Right.
I think to myself, why is that? I mean, these are
our
precious little humans, and they need us. They rely on us. They're so funny and they're so fun. And is it hard? Yes. But why do we have to make it sound like it's so terrible? Because it's not, you know. And
I feel the same exact way. Like, I don't understand it. And I don't relate. Like, I can't relate to that narrative, you know, of, like, the complaining and the, like, whatever. Like, I just can't do it. And I feel like, yeah, I was sleepy. But sometimes it wasn't Vance's fault. It was that I laid awake looking at photos of Vance on my phone.
Right.
Like, I could have been sleeping, but I was not. I missed him, or I was, like, doing something for me, you know, and he's still, I mean, he's almost two, and he still doesn't really sleep through the night. Like, he wakes up at, like, 6 or 7 every day, like, and then he'll go back to sleep. But, I mean, I'm used to that, like, whatever, you know, like, it's fine. There will be he's not going to do that for the rest of his life. And I fully believe there's going to be a time in his life that I miss that, like, that I wish he needed me, or that I wish I could hold him or wish I could console him. And he's like, Mom, you're so lame. Get away. Like, I just know that that's going to go by so fast. I know. Like, I'm not ready. Like, he already now, if I say I love you, he says no.
Oh, no.
Like, breaks my heart. But I'll say, do you love Mama? And he'll say, uh-huh. So I don't know. Like, we got to work on that.
Boys are the best. I have a 5-year-old, and he definitely is already too cool for me. You know,
so
I drop
fun.
Him off at school,
man.
And I'm like, Brooks, give me a hug and a kiss. And he does it so fast, it's almost like it didn't even happen.
You're like, already?
I know. Like, no. I'm already like, oh, man. Oh, well.
Oh, well, that makes me want to hug him even tighter.
Yes.
He turns 2 in January. So I'm like, hang on, buddy. Yeah. Like, we're going to be tight.
Go scoop him up. Give him a big hug. So as we talk about Vance, you know, and he's going to be watching you and learning from you and your husband as well. But, you know, as I think moms have a big impact on their children because of the pressures that society puts on us. And I guess my question is, what do you want Vance to learn from your hard work and your positive influence that you have on others?
Oh, gosh, I might cry on this one. I love that I'm raising a son who is not going to look at women or girls differently.
Yeah.
That, like, if they want to work, if they're good at their job, if they make money, if they do whatever, that's going to be normal to him. And he is going to be raised in a home where his mom is creative and she helps other people and she travels around and speaks. Like, it's not going to be weird for him when he's a man that there's a woman that is successful. Yes. And I love that so much. And I just want to, he's such a sweet boy. And I tell him all the time, which I mean, he's not going to remember this, but I'm like, I just hope you don't ever change. And he doesn't look like me, but he acts just like me. And mm-hmm. he has like my same inflections and my same tones and good and bad, like all the good things. But I'll yell at the dogs and say, no. And he'll like, with the Noah. And I'm like, where did you get that from? But it was for me. But it's just like, I hope that he's able to just pick up on the good things and the hard work. And, but also that like, that he never felt like I was too busy for him. You know, that he was always appreciated and he was always celebrated. My dad was a really hard worker and he was also an entrepreneur. Like, mm-hmm. so he worked all day and then had his business at night, just like what I did for a few years. And he just taught me that it was possible. Like, I never doubted it because I watched it happen and I believed it. And I just hope that with Vance, whatever it is that he wants to do, that he feels encouraged, but he feels confident because he's seen it done.
Yeah.
And so I just, that's my hope and prayer for him. But it's exciting. It's cool to think like what he could be, you know, and like what he could do or, you know, what his career, but I just want him to be happy.
Absolutely. And I think that him seeing you happy will lead him towards that too. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, I completely agree.
Yeah.
And I think if there's any moms out there who aren't in a happy situation or a good job or anything that doesn't bring you joy, like that's going to ultimately come back to your household. Like whether you want it to or not, like mm-hmm. you spend so much time at work that I feel like that can drain you, you know, and then you're not being able to show up and be the best for your family. And not that I like every single day is sunshine and rainbows, but I feel like I was able to set myself up for most of the days being like that, you know, like just being able to work for yourself and to control that. But it's kind of funny because if anything goes wrong, it's totally your fault.
There's like, no one else to blame it on. No,
that is on you, girl.
That's really funny.
So like there are very few bad days, but they're real bad.
But you also get like, to claim the totally successes.
That's exactly right. You get them all.
You get all the successes.
But it's so funny when you mess up. You're like, yeah, my shipping department forgot to order. You're like, that was me.
That was
my
me.
Bad.
That's so really funny. So. I have a couple more questions, but
sure, yeah.
You online have such a positive impact on others and have really, I think, built a community around your work and, you know, your authenticity and your joy. So is that something that, you know, you had to kind of work with to figure out your sweet spot online and in the online communities, or is that something that you just said, you know what, I'm just going to go out there and just be myself and spread joy, and it worked? What has that looked like for you?
That's such a good question. I was really, like, early on with Instagram, I didn't know what a community was. I didn't know what a platform was. Like, I had one follower, which was me on my other account. I was using, like, the Valencia filter and, like, the Nashville. I did not know. I never had, like, dreams or goals or intentions of having a following or growing that online community. But I just kept showing up and I just kept being me. And I think the coolest thing about having no expectations is that you're always surprised. Like, you're like, oh, okay, this is working. This is cool. I wasn't trying to, you know, trying to grow or trying to have all that, but then it just kind of happened. And I had to look back, like, once it started gaining steam and think, like, what are these people like? Like, what is it that they're seeing that they enjoy? And how am I different from all the other letters or all the other calligraphers out there? And it was really scary for me because I was bullied through high school, and I was definitely like, I was captain of the cheerleaders, I was homecoming queen, I was definitely what a lot of people would consider popular, but I was very unhappy. And all the things that make me now mm-hmm. were the things that girls picked on me for back then. And being too smiley, being too cheerful. There was a girl that said my ponytail swung too much when I walked down the hall.
Oh, man, that sounds like such a high school thing to say.
It was. I would not go back to high school if you paid me. But yeah. It was just really hard. And I was afraid to put myself out there online, and a lot of times I'm still afraid because I'm afraid those mean girls are going to come back, you know, and I'm afraid there's more of them out there, but so far so good. And I think, again, like, the positive outweighs the negative. And I just, probably in maybe like 3 or 4 years ago, I decided like for, I was spending a lot of time on Instagram and Instagram seemed to really be growing. And I decided to make like a mission for my social media. So just like I have a mission for my business, like I wanted to carry that on over there. And so instead of being like every single photo being of a product, like here's this thing I made, here's this shirt I sell, I wanted to give more, like really give more than what I was asking for. And so every single thing now, like I want it to spread joy and I want it to make people smile. And so I will occasionally sell something on there. Obviously I'm a business, but I'm showing motherhood. I'm showing life. I'm showing our house. I'm showing decorating ideas. Like I try to be more of like, here's our life and not just like, here's this girl who has pretty handwriting. Yeah. Like I think they would get bored with that a lot faster than if I'm just sharing more. And it is. It's really natural for me to be open online, but again, having everything like through the mission of spreading happiness and the mission of spreading joy, I'm never going to go online and complain. Like, it's really not my nature anyway. It's not that those things never happen or that I don't ever have bad days. That's just not the place that I choose to air those problems, you know, or like literally dirty laundry. There is dirty laundry. I'm not going to go post a picture of that. Right. You know what I mean? So I think it's just like kind of creating a space. Like I feel like the internet over, even in the last 5 years, like it kind of took on like some negative tones and, you know, with politics and just all kinds of things. Like it just kind of got to be like a darker place than what it used to be. And my goal has just always tried to be to keep it fun and to keep it positive. And so when I pop up in someone's feed, like I want them to be excited and to know that there's joy in that post, that there's like a smile buried in there somewhere. And not just, you know, like here's another person venting online. Yeah.
Well, and that's such a genuine reflection of your work too. So they go hand in hand, which is so wonderful.
And I'm totally that annoying friend that's like, oh, like, well, look at the bright side. Like I'm an Enneagram 7.
I was just about to say, if you are not an Enneagram 7, then I don't know what you are.
Like, I'm so like, they could be having the worst day. And I'm like, well, I love your shoes. Yes. Like, it's okay. Like, you're so good. And like, I mean, that is me. Like, through and through. It's
I'm a 7 too.
Me.
So I totally get it. Okay, good.
You understand. I totally understand. Get it.
That's why I identified you as a 7. And I was like, there's no way she's not a 7. No.
I know I took a lot of tests, but there was no need to confirm. I mean, I knew it as soon as I read it.
That's funny. And do you know what your husband is?
He's a 9.
He's a 9.
And so it's funny because, like, we got real deep in Enneagram. Like, I love it. Like, I went to a conference and learned how to, but poor Chris. Like, I go learn all this stuff and get all excited. And then I bring it home and I'm like, guess what? Like, guess about this new thing. And Chris has known me since first grade. We were middle school sweethearts. So
that's awesome.
He knew what he was getting into. Like, he's not surprised by, like, any of it. And he's not impressed either. Like, he's, like, my biggest cheerleader. But if people come up to me, like, when we're out, he just, like, shakes his head. Like, he's not at all like wowed by anything. But he's really funny and we don't argue a lot. Like neither one of us will like rock the boat. And it's not that we don't ever get annoyed. It's just that we don't like fight. And if you go look at our numbers, like I like always want to have fun. So I don't ever want to like have anything down or like anything negative.
Yeah.
And he never wants to rock the boat. So like,
works out well.
We have a very... Yeah, it's like hilarious. We better just bury it all and then it'll like come up at some random time. But no, it's just hilarious because like we are a really good fit together. So I read that Bob Goff and his wife are 7 and a 9.
Okay.
So it's a cool partnership to strive for. Hashtag goals, you know?
Yes, seriously. Bob Goff is the man.
I love him.
That's funny. Well, so as you think about, you know, what's next for you, I guess the question is what is next and what goals do you have as, you know, someone who's pretty new in your career in this industry? I mean, even though 5 years might have felt like a long time to reach some of those goals that you've reached, you're still pretty early on. You have a little one. What do you feel like is your next goal or thing that you want to do that maybe is not even related to your current business?
My next thing is a book for sure. I am working on that right now, kind of behind the scenes. There's going to be, I don't think I can say like the name or what it is, but there is a book in the works.
That's awesome.
And hopefully more than one. So there's one that's going to be coming in next fall, and then there will be another one after that, and then hopefully another one in the future. And so being an author is something that like, has always probably been a goal that I was too afraid to say. Like, yep. I felt silly saying I want to do that, but I used to love to write when I was a kid, and I won like a creative writing contest one time, and I was like so proud, and it's just really neat to be able to see that dream come, and it's just been really cool to just watch the way that it's taken place and how God's been in all that, and it's just a humongous dream of mine that's going to happen and that's going to come through. And so next year, thank you so much. Next year, that will be my number one focus, is writing and getting all that ready. I will still be teaching. I just, like, so far right now, I mean, my January and February are still booked just like they were this year, but I'm thinking that I will do even more teaching online than I did this year. So hopefully being able to come out with new classes online and new offerings and kind of tone down some of my in-person appearances right now. Because I'm going at least once a week right now. And so I think I kind of need to trade some of those in-person events for writing, yes. for like sitting down and typing.
Yes.
And so we'll see how that shakes out, you know, next year. Yeah. But I'm just so excited. I'm excited for that. I think that the online learning has been my new thing this year, and teaching classes online. And so that is super exciting. And, you know, it's gone really well. And I'm just so excited to be able to reach further than just the South and help and encourage. And I mean, there's people who are stationed overseas in the military that are able to take my classes. That's just been amazing. Really cool. Like, such a joy for me, and they've enjoyed it. And I'm really liking where that's headed. I don't ever see myself stopping in-person events, because I love that so much and look forward to that. And there's really something cool about getting to hug the necks of the people that follow you and to like meet them in person. But I think that some of that next fall may be shifting towards the book tour and stuff like that. So it just might have a little bit of a different vibe, but it'll still be me. And it's just an answered prayer, and it's just an amazing dream come true. And I think that's really what will carry me like into the next few years. Like, I really see me being able to work on the book and then write another book and just kind of keep that moving in that direction. And what's so cool like about a book is that lives on. Like, that's a legacy. Like, it's not just an Instagram post. Like, that's it's going to be out there for more than 24 hours, which is so exciting, but it's also really scary because you want to make sure you get it right.
Right.
And, you know, and
you can't undo it.
Right. Backspace doesn't work. Yeah. Whatever is out there. But I think that I just pray over it a lot, and that the people who receive that and who get that will hear exactly what they need to hear.
That is so exciting. I'm so excited for you. That's wonderful. Well, as we wrap up, if we think about, you know, a mom who has a little one and maybe isn't in that space where she feels like she's fulfilling her life purpose, or, you know, really has this itch to want to make a more of a positive influence either in her profession or in her community, what would be one tip that you would give to that mom to kind of move forward and take the next step and just do it with all the chaos of motherhood that might be around her?
First of all, I want to tell her that you are doing a great job. Like, you are doing awesome. If you're a mom and you're listening to this, you're doing great. Like, high five, congrats to you, because nobody tells us that.
Yes.
Like, we don't hear that. I think our job is to tell each other. And if a compliment pops into your head about another mom or another friend, like, that's laid on your heart so that you will open your mouth. Like, you need to tell her, because she's probably not getting that. But I think if I could tell you one thing to change, it would just be to do one thing every single day that is for you, that moves you towards that goal. So even if it just takes 5 minutes and it's an email that you could send, or if it's a blog post that you could write, or an Instagram post that you could write, or something you could Google, or something you could research. Like, if you just gave yourself 5 minutes or 10 minutes every single day that was something just for you, that wasn't for anybody else. And it's so easy to say we don't have the time, like, but I've really tried hard to stop saying that and just saying, no, I had it. I just spent it scrolling Instagram.
Yeah,
or I
didn't
had
make
that
time.
I just watched Netflix, or I had that time. I just hit snooze on my phone. And so it's just carving out just a few minutes to move that needle, and it doesn't happen overnight. Like, I would never say, like, go quit your job, like, join me, like, that you have a family to support, right? Like, we have to make really good decisions. But I think just kind of carving out, maybe setting an alarm on your phone that's like, hey, do something right now, like, that will help you in that direction, like, little by little, is really going to add up.
I love that. I think that's very sound advice. And thank you for giving our moms a high five, because it's very, very much needed, I think.
I think so, too. Like, yeah, I think if we see moms out and about, we need to be like, solidarity, sister. Like, we're in this together. I saw a mom at the airport yesterday. Her daughter was like losing her, you know what? Like, she was crying. Like, she was just crazy. And I was like, do you think it's her ears? Like, because we had just landed, you know how your ears pop on a plane? And I walked up to her. I'm like, I can help you. I was like, I'm not in a hurry. I have a 2-year-old. Like, do you need help? And so I like helped her with her daughter. And I said, can she have gum? Like, I have gum. I think that'll help her ears. And she was like, oh my gosh, like that would be so great. So here we are giving a stranger gum at the airport. But you know, that's neither here nor there. As a mom, we're all in this together.
Yeah, well, and as a mom, when you're in that moment, you're like, I'll do whatever takes.
It's fine. I'll take your stranger gum. This will work great. But it really did help. So I felt like, I was just glad I said something, because I feel like she probably thought everybody was like, oh my God, get your kid together. You know, like, and it wasn't her fault. Like, her ears just hurt. So yeah.
And we've all been there.
And like, I think just to supporting the other moms and like our other neighbors and friends, instead of like judging. You know, like that's absolutely the best thing we can do.
Yes, I agree. Well, thank you for that. So as we wrap up, I think we kind of hinted at this along the way, but tell people where to find you and maybe about your online course and your in-person courses and how to find those, because I don't think we got terribly specific, and I want to be sure people know how to do that.
Oh yeah, come hang out with me, please. I would love that. I would love to be your friends online. My Instagram is allshewrotenotes, and my website is allshewrotenotes.com. And you can find any of the online learning stuff there too, but there's an easier way. If you go to happyhandlettering.com, that link will always be giving you something free. So it'll always be some kind of free seasonal lettering course that's appropriate to that time or that season. And so that's a great way just to get a little taste and do something fun and free. And if you like that, then there will always be the opportunity to sign up for the full course as well. So that's happyhandlettering.com.
How fun. That's wonderful. Yeah.
I love like giving away. Like, let's go do this. Let's make this craft. Let's do this idea. So
that's
been
so fun. That's so fun. Well, thank you so much for your joy and authenticity and encouragement. And this has just been such a fun conversation to have. And I think you've probably inspired a lot of moms to go out there and have a positive influence on their community and other moms. So thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I love what you're doing here.
Thanks for listening, friends. I hope you enjoyed listening to this episode as much as I enjoyed recording it with Maghon. She is a true joy and has worked so hard to build her business while becoming a wife and mother. If you enjoyed this episode, please be sure to subscribe to the podcast to continue receiving new episodes every Tuesday. Leave a review on iTunes and let me know what you think. Thanks for listening, and see you next week.